Thank you so much for checking out this next message in the encouragement series. And you're going to want to find your Bibles, 1 Peter chapter 2. We made it. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 through 3 is where we're going to be. So open your Bible, scroll, find, however you search for that. Because we're going to be in the first three verses of chapter 2 as we begin to kind of move forward in this encouragement series. But before we go any further, let's pause and pray for God's blessing. God, we pray that you'll bless us with wisdom and discernment. They will hear and respond to you in a way that brings you glory, that helps us to become more like Jesus. So may we see our life before you and begin to understand how you're saying, look, here is where this applies, where this applies, this is what I meant by that. So we might help others have a close relationship with Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit. We love you, Lord, and thank you for this opportunity to be together. May it be a blessing and pleasing unto you. Might it bring you joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So in this encouragement series, the whole message theme, really the push of 1 Peter is to encourage you to bring God glory by living boldly like Jesus Christ. It's about holiness. It's about Christ-likeness. It's about going out there in a world that may be ever increasing against Christianity. It's about going out there in the world that isn't perfect, that's got sin in it, that's broken, your world, my world, the world, and representing Jesus Christ in what we do, what we say, what we think, how we feel, what we believe, our values, behavior, all of that stuff wrapped up into becoming more like Christ, because that's the pinnacle of human existence, is Christ-likeness. I mean, that's what we desire the most. That's what we're all going to look to ascend to. Heaven's going to be like that. We're all like Christ. So Peter's really trying to encourage people to have the courage to live the Christian life, to be gospel-centered, and to live in such a way that it influences and transforms others around them for the good of all, and biblically speaking as well. So as we move forward in this message, I think it's good to just have that overview that God wants the best for you at your workplace and where you worship, and really God wants to see you be like Christ, but he knows it's hard. He knows you have enemies against you. He knows that sometimes you war against yourself more than anyone else. So we have these passages of scriptures to help us in the life and in the world that we're living. Now, I know you've heard phrases, or you probably told stories where you ended up where, man, you just had to be there. You just had to be there to experience. You'd tell a joke or an anecdote from a vacation or something at work. Sometimes they're called inside jokes, but you're like, man, you just had to be there. It was amazing. Maybe it's a major sporting event, some sort of concert, something that you're like, boom, I remember when. I remember JFK's assassination. I remember the Challenger explosion. I remember the pandemic of 2020. I remember all of this stuff. And a lot of times we tell people that man, it's better than you had to be there, because we want them to have that shared experience. We desire to pull them into the narrative of our life and just simply say, look, this was an incredible moment. And what we can say about this passage of scripture that we're going to look at is literally you have to try this for yourself right now. As we move into this scripture, as we move forward into this passage, as in a second here, we look at this one thing. This is really something you have to try for yourself. There is you can know all these things about Jesus, but you've got to have a relationship with him. You can see the good that comes out of the Bible and Christianity and living that way. In fact, many major civilizations have prefaced, even our country, the United States, have prefaced their laws and their constitutions on biblical truth, because it is just the best, good, and right only way. So anyways, let me hit you with the one thing here, because it's really going to help you to kind of understand and lock in. I love this passage of scripture. The one thing says, taste and see that the Lord is good. I like the dynamics of this, because it's confusing. It's kind of paradoxical. It's personification. It's the reference to Psalm 34:8. We're going to see this come out again in 1 Peter, because that was the Bible in which the disciples and the early Christian used was the Old Testament, and they were living the New Testament as it was being penned here. But I love the passage of taste and see that the Lord is good, because it's so relatable. Like, we know what that is. We've slid our plate across the table and go, you've got to try this. We've got favorite foods. We've got favorite menu items. We've got favorite vacation spots. We've got favorite moments in life that were just epic, that we want to remember. And this passage of scripture brings that to us. Now, what we know from this Psalm passage and ultimately in this First Peter passage is that God knows when you let go of sin, when you let go of its influence on your life and you grab onto Jesus, then you're going to experience God's best. Let me say that again. When you let go of sin, when you don't play around with temptation, and you grab onto Jesus and biblical truth, that's when you get to experience God's best. And you might be sitting there and go, look, I'm not a Christian, but I'm experiencing God's best. The rain falls on my crops. I've done well at work with the intelligence and the abilities and the ambition that God's given me. I'm already experiencing His best. And I would say to you, no, you're not. No, you're not. There is more to life than just the common graces that fall upon everyone on the planet because God is good. There are specific graces sent wholly for God's kids, for His children. Just like there are specific blessings and good things that come to my kids and my wife because they're in my household that we give to each other. And I would just say to you that don't settle. Don't settle in your life. That's not what God wants. And sin makes you settle. Sin pushes you into submission to its evil ways and makes you think this is the best life can get. And it's really not. And it makes you think you'll have no strength in hardship. It makes you think that there's no health in weakness and sickness. But God's word says, no, that's totally different. In fact, God's word says, Psalm 34:8, and as we'll see in 1 Peter, you need to taste and see that the Lord is good. I love food. I don't know that I would necessarily call myself a foodie. Maybe call my wife a foodie because she always is pursuing the perfect bite. But I'm not. Everything just kind of has its own place. But here God's like, look, I want you to taste and see that the Lord is good. And it's a call to you individually. You've got to do it for yourself. You have to be there. It's better if you just try it for yourself. Don't take my word for it and experience. Take God's invitation to do that yourself. So here's kind of the context that we're getting for this specific passage of scripture as it blows out into our own lives. The context is just so much of life happens. So much life happens and God desires for us to become more and more like Jesus. So as life's happening, as things are taking place, God's goal is for you to respond to become more like Jesus, to think the way He thinks, to feel the way that He feels, all of that stuff. So in that desire, these passages of scripture we're going to look at, these three sentences, these three verses, if you will, are going to give us nourishment to our soul, but also action for life. Because eventually you've got to take the bite. Eventually you've got to go see the movie. Eventually you've got to go to the sporting event or the concert. Eventually you've got to show up in local church worship and praise God with other fellow Christians. Eventually you've got to get in to life. You've got to live it, not spectate, but actually live it out. And these passages of scriptures are going to help us to see that. So in 1 Peter chapter 2, we're going to look here at verse 1. In this section where it talks about the living stone and a holy people, God is still desiring and pursuing for us to be holy people. And now He's giving us very practical advice and understanding on who we are and what we need to do. So let's just look at verse 1 here. As we're trying to taste and see that the Lord is good. Verse 1. So put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. I would say to you, God would not tell you to do this if it was not possible in and through Him. You can't do this as your own individual. You can't get rid of hypocrisy just as a regular human. You need the divine power and strength and wisdom of God to do this. But can a human get rid of all malice and the intent to hurt someone? Can all humans get rid of all deceit, the ability to pull one over on one, to pull a fast one, to con somebody? Can humans get rid of hypocrisy and envy and the desire for someone else's stuff? Or all slander where we roll people through the mud and we say hurtful things. Can a human actually get there? Yes, they can. And this verse tells us how. It tells us how through an intimate relationship with God that we can do this. So what does God tell us to do to get rid of all malice, deceit, and hypocrisy? He's like, you got to put it away. You got to put it away. A toy hidden is less played with for my kids. And I do that. I've told this story a few times, how we rotate our kids' toys on like a 3 to 6 month cycle. They've got like winter toys and seasonal toys, and we put them in these tubs, put lids on them, and put them away, and they never get played with. And if I put those toys away forever, they'll never get played with again forever. The kids won't try to mess with them. They don't even really know that they exist. They have forgotten about them. They don't even ask for them. They don't even long for them. So God's like, look, put that away. Don't play with that. Don't toy around with that stuff. Because God goes that there's no good thing in the Christian's life. There's no good thing in the non-Christian's life that's going to come from this. So if we want to taste and see that the Lord is good, number one thing that's most capped and obvious to us is you got to eat good things. You've got to consume good things. And you're like, oh, God isn't real, and Jesus doesn't do anything for me, and the Holy Spirit is so weird, I don't even understand him. That's because, like this verse, you're not eating the good stuff. You've got malice and deceit and hypocrisy and envy and slander in your life. And some of the ways you're going to get rid of those is through forgiveness and just owning it. You're going to be like, look, I'm trying to be less envious, but I am envious. And I apologize, and I ask for forgiveness from you and from God, and he does, and they do. So you see that God's like, look, you've got to lay those down. Why? Because to keep with the food analogy, these are the things that create cavities in the teeth and the heart, mind, soul, and strength. These create cavities and holes and chasms in your heart and in your mind when you've got malice. So God's like, look, if you want to taste and see that the Lord is good, you've got to stop eating the things that are just putting cavities in your soul, that are creating emptiness in you, empty calories from my fitness friends, right? You just consume and you consume, and it does nothing good for energy. It does nothing good for your brain or muscle development. It's just wasted calories. And these things hurt us. These things clog the arteries of our spiritual heart. And God's like, look, if you're going to be a holy people, if you're going to strive for Christ's likeness, if you want to taste and see that the Lord is good, the first thing you've got to do is you got to put these things away through the power of God. Resist temptation, resist the devil in the name of Jesus, because you're saved and because you're a Christian. If you're not a Christian, I'll just tell you, you got no hope of putting this stuff away. You can't do it. And you might do it for 6 months or a few years, but you're going to relapse. It's going to become a habitual sin. Without relying on the power of God, we cannot overcome sin. We can't. Verse 2. Look at verse 2. So God's like, look, these are just some of the things we need to put away. Just giving us some, you got to put this away, right? Hate in your heart. And in the world of the first century Christians, which we're looking here around 60 AD, these Christians had a lot of malice to the Romans and the Jews because they were being persecuted by them. They're being persecuted by the government. They'd be persecuted by other religions. They weren't allowed to shop, buy, pray, worship wherever they wanted because of that. And that created a lot of that. So in verse 2, as the Bible always does, it says, not only are these things not what we're like to be a Christian, these aren't part of the Christian makeup. This isn't what it is to be a citizen in the kingdom of God. Verse 2 tells us what it is. So like newborn infants. So think of the newborn babies you've been around, or maybe you've had them in your own life, or you even have them now. So like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation. Now I've had three kids. Correction. My wife has had three kids. I've just been there. So I've got three kids, and I can tell you that this verse is absolutely true for my kids. Each of the newborn infants have longed for that pure milk. That's what they wanted. In fact, as parents, we were so diligent to make sure we gave them the right temperature on the wrist. We would check the milk temperature. We made sure it was good. We made sure it was right. We read the ingredients. I mean, we were just so diligent in giving that. And my kids were so diligent in crying and screaming their guts out for it. I mean, they just, there were a few things in their life that mattered most. And it was eating, it was sleeping, and getting rid of the food they ate. That was their whole life. And then when it says to desire for that, you've got to understand from this scripture, what does God want us to have as Christians? I mean, what does this mean for us? If I'm putting away those other things, sin and its influence, then what am I pulling in? Like, how do I grow up into salvation? Does that mean salvation isn't salvation? That I got to grow up into it, then I'm saved? No. What this is talking about, what God wants us to have, is maturity. That's what it's talking about. The reason my kids long for that, one of the many reasons they long for that milk, was because they needed it to grow. They knew, inherently knew, because God made them that way, that without that nutrition, without that substance, they weren't going to grow. And they could, their bodies would tell them that. Their stomachs would tell them that. Their energy levels would tell them that. Their sleepiness would tell them that. They needed that. So God's saying in this, when you're growing up into salvation, it's taking that salvation and taking that next step. It's time to be mature, Christians. It's time to grow up. It's time non-Christian to stop playing around in this life and be mature. You might be 30, 40, 50, 80, 90, 100. Just because your body's old doesn't mean you're mature. And just because you're young doesn't mean you're immature. So we grow up into this maturity. Now, what is that maturity specifically referenced to here? It's longing for the pure spiritual milk. You have to answer the question, what is that pure spiritual milk? It's Jesus Christ. It's the Word of God. It's wanting that more than sin. Because the first verse in chapter 2 prefaces it and says, you got to put that stuff away. Why? Because you want that and you're longing for it. You're longing for the wrong things. And you put that away and you start longing for what's good. Christ-likeness. You know you want it. You know that you need it. So you have to strengthen in maturity. So what's Christian maturity anyways? Just in a nutshell, what is Christian maturity? Christian maturity in a nutshell is responding to life biblically. Not responding to life in good ways, smart or wise ways, so that can fall under the biblical umbrella of life. But when we're talking about spiritual maturity, there are two things at play. One, you're consuming the Bible, you're consuming Jesus, you're worshiping together, you're living out Jesus in the workplace, you're living out Jesus in the neighborhood, you're recharging yourself with Jesus, you're living that out, because consumption equals output. What you're consuming is what's in there, right? You are what you eat. So what you consume, if you are to taste and see that the Lord is good, then you must consume the Word of God. And you can do that in a variety of ways, creative ways. A couple years ago, I might need to bring it back, but we did a series on spiritual disciplines, inner and outward. How do we draw close to God, inner in our soul? How do we draw close to God outward? So some of you sketch and you draw and you run and you lift and you sing and you craft and you engineer and you do all of these things that help draw you close to God. Obviously, prayer, reading the Bible, servicing Him, right? Gospel-centered worship, gospel-centered community, gospel-centered service, gospel-centered multiplication. All of those things are in our lives. And what God's telling us to do here is He's like, look, like the newborn infants, we all see babies around us. When they're crying, they're longing for that spiritual milk. You've put the other stuff away. What do you replace it with? What do you replace it with? You replace it with Jesus Christ. You replace it with the longing and the desire for His Word and not sin anymore. Not sin anymore. That's how we become a holy people. We put away sin. We grab on to this milk. Look at verse 3. Look at verse 3. Follow verse 3. Mark verse 3. Here we go. Now, here's the condition to this. Because it's sort of those if-then statements. If you do this, then that's going to happen. If you hit your thumb with a hammer, then it's going to hurt, right? So verse 3, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. So there's a premise, right? Long for spiritual milk, seek maturity, but you can't be a mature Christian unless you've tasted and seen that the Lord is good. So what does that mean? What does it mean to taste and see that the Lord is good? Some of you might think communion. Yes, that's a great example. You can take communion every day on your own, should you desire. But you can take communion. You can literally, that's a literal tasting and seeing and remembering the goodness of God. But also what it's talking about here specifically is that what it means to taste, what it means to see that the Lord is good, is talking about taste that the Lord is good in salvation and see through relationship that He is good. So what does that mean? You must be saved and then you must be in a relationship with Jesus. There's so much good to experience from God, forgiveness, strength, and purpose. So what I would say to you is, one, be saved, person who isn't, a non-Christian, non-identifier of any religious faith, atheist or some other faith. Those religions are all false. They're going to lead you to hell. They're going to send you into the life of needless suffering and not experiencing God's best. No strength and hardship, no direction and wisdom in the difficult decisions. So I would say be saved. Call on the name of the Lord. Just confess your sins, known and unknown, commission and omission, and just say, God, forgive me. I believe that you are Lord and Son of God. Forgive me. Be Lord of my life. Be the Messiah who saves, and I will follow you. So Paul's saying, look, if you are a Christian, because that's who he's writing to. If you are a Christian, if you're watching this and you're one of the third of the people on the planet that claim Christianity is their faith, if you are a Christian, then I would say, that you have tasted and you have seen that the Lord is good, begin to live that out. So the path is salvation, being born again, and then it's Jesus in, Jesus out. Not garbage in, garbage out. And I know that that steps on toes, and I know that's hard to say, because you're going to have to evaluate all the things in your life. You're going to have to evaluate your music. You're going to have to evaluate the freedom that you have in things that you watch, the things that you eat and do. My advice to you is go to Romans chapter 8 and allow God to flesh out for you those things you are allowed to consume and those things that are not yet ready for you to consume. And if you're worried about whether or not you're doing something that pleases God, Romans 8 is going to help you there. It's just going to bear forth wisdom to help you to understand that. But remember, when we're talking about tasting and seeing the Lord is good, that's his invitation to relationship through salvation. There will be no one in heaven who wasn't saved by Jesus Christ. We know that he died on the cross for the forgiveness of all of our sins, and he was raised from the dead by the power of God so that we might find forgiveness and live with him forever and have his guidance and direction and strength now through the Holy Spirit as we walk this earth. So really, the dilemma that you have is, where is your life? Jesus in, Jesus out, garbage in, or garbage out? Sin in, sin out, temptation in, temptation out? Where is it? And look, I'll be honest, you're probably more like me. More than likely, it's not all one or the other. You're on this life journey where you're trying to be more Jesus in and more Jesus out, but occasionally some garbage gets in and some garbage comes out, and you need forgiveness. But when God calls us to say, taste and see that the Lord is good, what do you got on your plate today? What have you already done and consumed with what you see and what you taste and how you've lived? Has it been good and pleasing? Does it bring God joy? Is it what he desires and wants? So as we close in prayer, that's what I want you to dwell on. Are you tasting and seeing that the Lord is good? And by the way, the Lord is good in easy times, and he's also good in hard times. Some would even say and argue, and I would probably side with them, that the tasting of the Lord's goodness is most evident in the hardships of life. In the storms and in the difficulties, you accept the reprieve and forgiveness that much more. God, we pray. We pray right now for those who are watching this that aren't Christians. They need to be saved. They're not tasting and seeing any goodness. There's no maturity in them. And they're trying to be more mature. And they're just trying to work harder and smarter and bootstraps and just trying to do this all that they can. And it's just not working. They make it for a few months, then they fall. Or for a day or an hour, then they fall. And Lord, we pray for their salvation. Because the only way to truly mature and to grow is to come through Jesus Christ, the perfect model and example. So we pray for their salvation. We pray that they will sit and rest and know that God has forgiven them for all their wrongdoing, all their wrong thinking, and all their wrong sayings. That he is the one true Lord, the one true Messiah, the one true Savior of all. I pray that they'll be born again. Friends, family, strangers who are watching this, who are just simply friends we've not met yet, we pray for your salvation. Do it now. Quit messing around with your life and wasting it. Wasting it in promotions and goods. But instead, let God come in and bless you in your poverty. Let God come in and help you through your riches. Let God help you in this to find purpose and value. And Lord, for all of us Christians, might we remember that we serve a good God. And that we can taste and see that after salvation, we can then have a good, right relationship with him. So Lord, we pray as we study the Bible, as we sketch and draw and eat and fellowship and hang out and spend time with each other, that we'll begin to see these things and live in a way that draws others in to this relationship, Lord. So we thank you for 1 Peter. We thank you for Psalm 34, Lord, that we might be able to taste and see. And that's what we pray. Help us to remember that there's a good God out there. No matter how bad the world is around us or how much we might war against ourselves, there are growing pains, but you're right there, Jesus, to help us grow and live. So God, let's do that today. We love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And we commit ourselves to be more like Christ. Amen. I love you guys. Have a great and wonderful rest of the day.